So, in continuing to talking about Disgaea Afternoon of Darkness, the PSP game, here now I'm going to talk about the gameplay mechanics. And Disgaea is not only wacky and crazy in terms of the story, but also in terms of gameplay. I do want to warn people that Disgaea is geared towards hardcore SRPG gamers. For people not used to like basic SRPG, how basic SRPG mechanics work, I recommend that people play like something less hardcore before jumping into complex yet pretty intuitive mechanics at work in Disgaea. The one most intuitive thing about the gameplay mechanics of Disgaea is that actions aren't executed until you click on the execute option. Thus, moving characters around and arranging moves can be cancelled out easily as long as you don't execute the moves. This makes the gameplay extremely fluid and extremely intuitive, although for newcomers to this mechanics, it's extremely alienating. So, this is a huge contrast to something like, when people think of SRPGs, I guess the most popular title they think of is Final Fantasy Tactics. And it's a stark contrast to that. When you have a Final Fantasy Tactics, you move a character, you confirm the move, you position them, and that's it. You move that character. You can't cancel that character moving. If your character has moved there and performed that action, it has to perform that action. In Disgaea, what you do is you move the character, you tell it to do this attack, it doesn't do it yet. You can move the other characters around and da-da-da-da, and then you find out this character moves here and it does a better job. You cancel this character and then he moves back. And you arrange everything, and then you go to the menu, and then you hit execute, and then they do their action, and that after you put the execute, then you can't cancel. But before you hit execute, you can cancel. You know, and that really really frees up your strategy. You can really plan out, well, I don't really want to do this. I really want to do this instead. You can do that without the stress of, I already made this, I can't cancel this, oh my god, what am I going to do now, you know, kind of thing. So this guy really streamlines, and it's a really intuitive mechanic, with just moving and attacking. There are other unique aspects of this guy mechanics as well, because this guy isn't the only SRPG to feature this kind of canceling thing. But the most notable thing is the geo panels. These small pyramids, or color pyramids, they're different colors, affect whatever terrain it's on. So if you destroy the pyramid, the geo panel, and it's a red panel and it's on, wait, not destroy. If it's a red panel and it's on like a red tile, all the red tiles will have the same effect. And these effects include like boosting enemy stats, like increasing their attack or defense, or giving you double the experience points when you kill someone on that tile. And these add a lot of strategy to the game because they will affect whatever color panel they're on. So the color tiles they're on really affect the thing. So if you're on a blue tile and an enemy boost geo panel is on a red tile and you're on a blue tile, you're okay. And the enemy, if the enemy is on the red tile, the enemy is not boosted. If the enemy is on the red tile and the geo panel is on the red tile, then you will have a harder time trying to kill that enemy when it's on the red tile. But this is why there's another mechanic is you can lift the enemy up and you could throw the enemy to another tile of the other color. So you can actually, but that's an action. So the character can't do an attack. You're substituting attack for lifting and throwing. Lifting and throwing is the one thing that you can't cancel. You do that even if you don't use execute, you've done it. That's one thing that's not cancelable. But other than that, you know, you have that aspect too. You can also lift and throw your ally characters so that you can lift like a stack of tower of characters and throw so that the character that you want to attack that can go really far across the map. That's one of the strategies involved in the game. But geopanel itself is a whole another ball game, because when you destroy the geopanel So let's say you have a red geopanel, and the tile it's on is blue. You destroy the red geopanel on the blue tile, then the effects of that geopanel is eliminated. No, the effect no longer exists. Like, for example, enemy stat boosting no longer exists. But the blue tiles will now turn to red, and it will turn to red, and it will destroy all the tiles that were on. It will do damage to stuff that was on that blue tile, which is now red tile. If the enemies were on it, it will hurt the enemies. If your allies were on it, your allies will be hurt. If another geopanel was on there, it will destroy that geopanel. Now, if that geopanel was a different color than the color it changed to, then the tile will change into that color again. This is how you create chains, geochains. So, if the more you create chains, the more skill level you unlock, you gain up. The more level you get up, if after you beat the stage, that's the reward you get. You know, if you have level 10 is the maximum. If you have level 9 and you beat the stage, you'll get a really, really good. You get all the items. You get level 8 item, level 7 item, level 6 item. Those, you get really good rewards. And there's so many interesting level design that involve these geo panels. So it's a really, really deep strategy game. Even before we go into the actual, the turn-based mechanics themselves. Let's see, where am I right now? Because I wasn't reading this. I gave too many examples. Right. Some terrain is only available by lifting and throwing. Also, another thing about lifting is when you lift an enemy, the enemy can't attack when you're holding. So you end the turn with the enemy lifted. The enemy is pretty much powerless to do anything. But the thing is, because you're lifting, you actually hurt yourself in the next turn. So you have to sacrifice that the enemy is way too, if the enemy's attack is way too powerful, you have to sacrifice a character to kind of hold on and to lift. Some characters will die under the weight because some enemies are so heavy. Now, those are really streamlined and intuitive, but there are some problems with Disgaea mechanics. And one of that is item management. Item management is not really fluid, it's just really messy. This is a system in which items are managed between an item bag, which is capable of holding 16 items, and a warehouse, which is capable of holding up to 256 items or weapons. Only the items in the item bag can be accessed during battles or in the Dark Assembly, and we'll talk about Dark Assembly probably in the next video. And so you can imagine what item management in this game is such a pain. You know, every time you want to take something to the battle, you have to take it out of the warehouse and transfer it back and forth. And every time you want to do the Dark Assembly thing, which is totally separate from the battle, and you'll need different items. The items you use in Dark Assembly are totally different from the items you use in battles, because items you use in battles are stuff that you want to use. Items in Dark Assembly that you pick up are stuff that you want to kind of throw away. So this whole having to manage between items in the item bag and the warehouse, it gets really messy and frustrating. I understand the reason behind it is because if you can access every single item in your warehouse during the battle, it makes the game way too easy. But even so, I mean, there must have been a better way to do this than something like this. And there is. Disgaea 3 kind of fixes this up a lot. It's still the same, but you can carry more items. And I don't remember what exactly are the differences, but it feels really different in Disgaea 3, the second sequel. The direct sequel, Disgaea 2, still has this management problem. Although the warehouse can carry more items, and the item bag can carry more items. The other huge problem is how you earn experience points. By this point, I'm at 8 minutes 34, so I think I have enough time. A character only earns experience points when he or she kills someone. Now, this doesn't matter for a warrior-type character, but it makes it really difficult to level up non-offensive units, like healing mages or low-attack, high HP monsters or tank. You know, you're just using monsters to soak up damage so that they don't attack the other characters. Those kind of units where they're not killing, but they do damage to other, it's really difficult to get them leveled up. The only way to really get healing mages leveled up is to do team attacks. Team attacks is when a character attacks, not a special attack, just attack, a regular attack, but when they're doing attack, their other characters are next to the other character. You can have three other characters next to the character, behind, on the sides, right? And there's a possibility that the characters that are close together will attack with them. When they do that and they kill someone, this team attack has to kill in order for all of them gets the same experience points. But if they do the team attack and they don't kill, that's the sacrifice you have to make. You don't know really how much damage you're going to do with the team attack. In order for, so do you sacrifice possible kill so that your healing mage will possibly get leveled up? Or do you just kill it by doing a special attack with one of the characters? This is a dilemma that shouldn't be there. If the healing mage levels up just by how much the, you know, magic he uses, or you know how much he heals, then it makes it makes perfect sense. But the healing mage has to kill people, which, you know, the weapons that healing mage uses to attack are horrible, and they have no offensive magic spells. So I don't really get the point behind that. And this is an issue only of Disgaea 1. Disgaea 2 and 3, they fixed this problem. So again, this is one frustrating aspect of the first game of the series. Okay. And this is not only for the healing mages, but also for the regular offensive mages as well, and other attack characters. I mean, it's just, you know, you want these characters to level up and get more powerful, and that's the fun of it. But it's just so hard when the level, when they level up, the only way they do so is by killing other enemies. So still, even with this frustration, the combat mechanics are very intuitive, and strategic elements are very innovative. So grinding, as frustrating as it can turn out to be, is actually really addicting. And in Disgaea, you can't, when you in other RPGs, when you fully level up, you're level like 99, level 100. In Disgaea, guess how much levels you can level up to? 9,999. Yeah, that's a lot of levels you can level up to. And it's not like one level can take 1 minute. No, it still takes just as much time to level up one level as in other games. But then later on, you'll see why. There's a way for a level 200 characters to be a level 2,000 character, so you get so much experience points, and that level 200 character all of a sudden becomes level 1,500, right? So there's that. That's why you can level up so much, because you have to find a way, strategically, really smart ways to defeat enemies that are so much higher level than you. But other than that, you know, there's really addiction in creating characters and leveling up your characters and customizing them. And that's really the where you get addicted. And that's why you can spend up to like 500, 600 hours with this game only on the first playthrough. Which is insane. You know, it's a really time-consuming game. You really don't begin this game until you beat it. You know, so that's really on the game mechanics. On the next video, you thought you were finished, huh? On the next video, I'm going to talk about the item world and the Dark Assembly, which are really unique additions. So, we got a wacky storyline. You got pretty wacky, interesting gameplay mechanics, especially with the geo panel. And now you got even more wackier stuff that's going to come up.